Hello, Couch Co-opers, Couch Potatoes, and Couch Codependents. This is the Couch Co-op Show, the greatest video game show in the world. We are a group of close friends sharing our love of gaming with you. I'm Ian, along with Jared.
Hi there.
Aaron.
Hello.
Scott.
What up?
Dave is still out, but joining us tonight, we have Emily. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Hello.
Remember, you can be a part of the conversation by leaving comments and questions over on Twitbook, InstaFace, and Gramter at Couch Co-op Shows, all one word.
No hyphen.
You can find our podcast wherever they are sold, or just go to couchcoopshow.com. Also, try following us tonight on twitch.tv/thecouchcoopshow. We stream live. Our show live every Monday night at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Okay. All right, take a breath.
It keeps getting longer and longer. Oh, my God.
These things happen.
Social media.
How's everybody tonight?
Pretty good.
Pretty good.
Yeah, it's been a good day.
Yeah.
Well, we have a guest, a first-timer on the show tonight.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us.
Yes.
Yeah.
Welcome.
I don't know if Scott said anything. We have a couple questions we like to ask first-timers.
No, he did not.
No, okay. That's cool. Yeah. Awesome.
Take that. Go.
Firing. All right. First of all, we want to know, how did you get into video games? What was the first video game you played? How did you get involved with it?
I got into video games when I was 3 years old. My sister was 6 years older than me and spent an entire summer saving money for a Super Nintendo. And I just got to play it by default, which was great. And I think Super Mario World was my first video game.
Good awesome. Place to start.
Good game. Yeah.
And
good
I actually wound up being the video game nerd, not her. And I went on to get many more consoles and keep playing video games.
What's it about video games that you enjoy so much?
I think the imagination and just being able to escape and go into another world is really fun.
Yeah.
Awesome. I think that's all why we all really, I think that's a common, something we share commonly. And then the difficult question, what is your favorite video game? Maybe it's difficult. Favorite video game of all time?
I can't pick a favorite video game, but my favorite video game story genre, whatever, would be all of the Zelda titles.
Okay.
Zelda all the way.
Okay.
You couldn't rate those Zelda games?
Come on, just say A Link to the Past. Come on.
Ocarina of Time.
Okay. Yes.
There we go. Yeah. Good game.
All right. Awesome. No, very cool. Thank you for joining us on the show tonight. Yeah. We are having this awesome Nintendo Switch show, but before we get to that, we have a hot take to do because a very big game dropped.
Hot take.
Friday. So we have a bunch of opinions. This game is hot this weekend. We played a bunch of it. Anthem came out, guys. You want to just go around the table and kind of share your thoughts on the game?
I would like to be playing it right now. Yeah.
Get on the show. Get on the show.
Yeah, it's hooked me.
That's all you got.
No, I mean, just you said like their first quick opinions.
So congratulations. Well, I mean, we can talk about a little more than that. I mean, you can share some feelings about it.
Yeah, the critics must have been mostly on PC on like super early access because I'm enjoying every moment. Yeah, it has loading screens, which are very abundant, but that's okay. It's nice to actually have a game where you can have a bathroom break every once in a while.
I don't think the loading times are that bad.
No, they're not that bad. Bloodborne was worse, and you died a lot in that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's not as bad. But the gameplay is so smooth and feels so good. You can master the javelin so quickly and feel like you're awesome at it. I mean, it's just all the guys, I'm sure. But
every
it just
first
feels
person shooter,
great.
I've always been so into melee and Halo, the plasma sword. This one from the get-go, they're just like, rip it up. Just go right in and just start wailing on these guys. So I like that it's your choice on if you want to be a shooter or just punch them in the face kind of player.
Yeah, the melee does need a little bit of work on some of the other classes. Like the Storm, you really shouldn't be on the ground punching things because it does like one move And then there's a big delay, like 2 seconds, well, before you can attack again.
The game is very class oriented. I mean, you have rogue that has its like knives and attacks things physically. You have the big colossal guy who's like the tank and has a shield and he charges things. The storm guy is a magician and shoots magic. Yeah. And then you have the ranger that just kind of does everything. So
do you pick all your characters, or do you have a group set of characters that you switch out?
So you start. You get to pick your first javelin, which is the suit you wear, and then like every few levels you get to pick a new one. So you get all of them and you get to choose depending on the group you're in how it works best. Generally everyone's playing the storm, but
that's me.
I like to mix it up obviously with whoever's playing what, just so we have like a more even grouping of javelins, because it makes the fight a lot easier when you're fighting different things, just like any kind of other RPG MMO type of thing. So I think the game is, I think the game is beautiful. I beat it. I beat the main, story campaign. Jared and I were talking about this weekend. I probably put in close to 30 hours, if not 30 hours.
And it came out Friday.
It did come out Friday.
Wow.
So, well,
do the math on that.
That's fast.
That's impressive.
I think the story is wonderful. I think the level design, the character designs are all really beautiful, but the level design itself, like the verticality of it and just the amount of exploration in that world is just superior. I've not played an open world game with this kind of level design ever. It's beautiful. Like the waterfalls and the jungle life is super cool. The flying, like Jared said, the flying is super cool. The level of customization is really fun. And
so I have to point out, while I was watching your stream, there was some things missing, because I've been playing with my PS4 Pro on a 4K TV, and they really nailed it. Just the lighting effects on the jetpack alone are way, way cooler. Just the light shining in your face. There's a lot of different cool flowing
flexing
colors.
His muscle here. Like, I got a better PlayStation than you, brah.
No, I played 4K. With Jason has a 4K TV and a Pro, and somebody else I played has it. So I'm not the only one. So, just enjoying it, and that nice. 4K goodness is actually worth it. I think the second patch they released actually had big HDR improvements because it was lacking.
I like seeing that between the demo and the full version, we had noted how the water was so dark you couldn't even see where you were swimming. But
yeah,
they really lightened it up.
Noticeable effects, and probably from complaints.
Right.
They
some nice little fixes. There was a patch day two, a 10-gig patch, so they definitely did like a nice shine on the game and probably fixed a few bugs on the original release.
I have a couple questions. The first one was asked last night by Palm Piloter. Actually, they're both from him. But
Nick.
Nick, who was on the show from, what's his, I'm forgetting the name.
Dialogue Tree,
yes. He asked, last night he asked me, is there enough single player content? Now, I was talking to Jared about this earlier. The way I played the game is that you can play the entire game co-op, multiplayer, but I did all the main story campaign solo on normal. So, because the game does if you're playing with certain randoms, they'll push you through the story, they'll push you through the game, and the game will kind of teleport you around, and it's kind of annoying. This I found out in the demo of the beta. So, all the story stuff, I didn't want to be pushed through that, so I play the game solo on normal. Then, any of the multiplayer stuff, when I play with these guys, I don't have to worry about the story content. They take me where they want me to go. I'm not trying to push through or anything. And then we're usually setting it on hard because with a bigger group, it's way easier to plow through on normal.
Yeah, so yeah. If you're plowing through just on the first couple of missions, just boost it up to hard. You may die a few times, but whatever. There's a little challenge to be had, and that's
okay.
Yeah,
you got plenty of people to bring you back. I mean, you don't want to leave your dude stranded.
Yeah, sometimes if you're trying to push forward too far, you get kind of screwed because you're just way, way back in the level and there's enemies everywhere and you'll just sit there for like 5 minutes waiting for them to clear them out to get far enough
Help
to
me.
Resume or revive you, and that can be obnoxious. So just be careful.
How much gameplay would it take to actually beat the game? How many hours do you think?
You wouldn't actually. Well, here's
is
the
thing. Is there a way to beat the game? Well, or is it just
No, I mean, the main story has a campaign and it's about 20 hours, and then you actually roll actual credits. It rolls actual credits. But then it opens up all the end games. It starts to open up all the end game content. And this is where it becomes like Destiny or a game that game as a service where they have all these other events going on, and like an MMO would or something like that. So the main story, I think about 20 hours I mean, you could push through all, like, if you don't really want to deal with any, there's like a lot of BioWare Mass Effect-y dialogue stuff that you could just not do or push through, and you could probably get through it quicker than that. But if you just sit down and enjoy the game, I would say a good 20 hours.
Nice.
Yeah, and after you hit level 30, there's three new difficulty levels, so it gets harder and harder and harder, and you have to have very fine-tuned teams, I would say, probably one of each of the javelins, so takes a lot more thought.
All right, well, end this segment with Nick's one more question. This is kind of a big question. Do you think that Anthem will be able to stay popular over the next handful of years, or do you think that its relevance will fade too quickly?
So I wasn't done the Destiny tree. What made people go from Destiny to Destiny 2? Like
the gameplay.
The gameplay. So
I burnt out. Like I burnt out of Destiny.
If there were to be an Anthem 2, I mean, we're still looking at least a year or two of like solid Anthem play before we hit that.
I think the problem with Destiny was there was a Destiny 2. No, I'm serious. I think if it had stayed, if it had stayed Destiny and not done a sequel like Activision wanted, I think I'd probably still be playing it. I think a lot more people would have been.
Oh yeah.
Cool. So I hope they keep just.
I think that's the key. Anthem. I think if BioWare can just keep churning out content and just focus on their game, I think it'll stay relevant. But if EA makes them pull out, because I mean the game's on the internet, it seems like the game's not doing well. Even though you know we'll see. But so I guess it's kind of a wait and see. But I do recommend the game fully. I think the game is really good.
Me too.
I wouldn't believe all these like critics that are just hating on it. So. Not like Fallout 76 was like this kind of mess. Anthem is not that at all.
Yeah, and if you want to be like me and not invest the full price into it, just Redbox it, because right now it is hot. A lot of people are playing it. It's great to do groups. Oh. Jump on it when everyone's playing it.
All right, let's get to some quick news really quick.
News!
Some more running long comments. All right. Dreams Creative Mode enters into early access this spring for $29.99 only on PSN. Ubisoft replaces controversial DLC ending in AC Odyssey this week.
Good.
After Bethesda bans player for having too much ammo, they lay out their six-month roadmap for making the game better. Ha! Wow. More mass layoffs from Guild Wars 2 developer ArenaNet. That's sad. Division 2 open beta is this weekend. I will probably be trying that on every platform except Switch. Speaking of Nintendo, Reggie Fils-Aimé retires.
Fils-Aimé.
Whatever.
Bobby's not ready.
Bowser takes over Nintendo of America.
That's so perfect.
Year of Bowser.
Did you see that photo of Bowser too in his office where the Mario and Luigi were tied up with a controller?
That's kind of awesome.
No, but this is like an old photo from like way back in the day. That, like when he first got his job there or something. It's pretty funny.
That's great.
You should look for it on Twitter or something.
That's pretty funny.
Rumors, Microsoft planning to unveil two Xboxes at E3 this year. But even crazier than that, Xbox Game Pass coming to Nintendo Switch.
Yes.
What the fuck? Do any of you want to talk about any of that?
I want to talk about the Dreams beta thing being available this spring for $30. I'm surprised they're actually making it for $30.
That's just the creative mode.
Just the creative mode.
Oh, okay.
But so what I got.
You can still, you can still download stuff and play through it and create. Well, so
my question is, does it like... that when if you decide to buy the full game itself, does that money spent on the
so here's
beta
the thing
access
they've already explained this. So if you do buy in on early access for $30, you will get the rest of the game without the added price.
Oh, okay,
I'm in.
So FYI, if you want to get it cheaper,
dream on.
Yeah, and it's pretty cool. I mean, the amount of creativity and stuff you can create with that game is super awesome. Or they also just want people to test other people's creative stuff. So you know, they need creators and players.
Nice.
All right, let's move on. To our topic this week.
Topic!
We haven't... we're kind of like a PlayStation-centric, a little bit PlayStation-centric, though most of us have Switches, which is, you know... But we're kind of PlayStation-centric, so we thought we'd talk about the Nintendo Switch.
Yeah.
And we wanted to kind of talk about our three... kind of the three games we would recommend. The games we like, but we would recommend to someone who just got a new Switch. But I also just want to start off the conversation with our thoughts of the Switch. Like, what do we think of it? Where it's at right now? What could they improve on?
I love it. It's amazing. It's great. I think the best thing about the Switch is that if I'm playing on the TV and my husband comes home and he doesn't want to watch me play video games, I can just pick up my Switch and keep playing and everything's fine and no fights escalate.
That is always nice.
Yeah, the convenience factor is nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely.
I have never plugged it into my TV. I only play it handheld.
Yeah, I think I play it more handheld than I do on the TV, yeah. Unless it's like a really nice HD Breath of the Wild type scenario.
I think because it's only 720, though, I would notice the resolution difference on my television. And I think because it's on a smaller screen, it looks more pristine. I because I'm a video guy, I notice these things. So I've just... And then... For some reason, I like it better handheld. I wish the Vita was still around. I always wanted a Vita and never got one. And I just think, I don't know. I always have these like dream, like these like illusions of like all this mobile gaming that I never do though. So it's, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't play my Switch as often as me I either. Should, I suppose, because I have so many games that I love to play on my PS4. And when I'm not on my PS4, I'm usually with my daughter or whatever. So I'm not just going to sit on the couch next to her and play a game. You know, you actually have to interact with children. So,
right.
Yeah, so you can't really do that. But it's nice just to be able to go back into the bedroom, hang out with my wife, and be able to just play a game and hang out.
Right.
When I go to Outrage, the esports bar, the Switch is always at full capacity. There's never just two people playing. It's always 4 to 6.
Nice.
And that truly brings, like, the couch co-op to gaming again, because I mean you're physically playing on the same screen and you're all sitting around, and it caters so well to multiplayer. The fact that the Joy-Con alone is two players from the get-go makes it just so welcome to bring in and have friends play.
Yeah, I was babysitting my friend's kids last week, and they have a Wii U that is on the fritz, about to die, and they have a PS4. And they just don't have any multiplayer games for the PS4. And they were actually complaining about it when they got back. The parents, like, they don't really have anything except for that, like, the soccer ball with the...
Oh, Rocket League?
Yeah, that. The rest is, like, Tom Clancy and Fortnite. And I was like, well, you should probably get them a Switch. And then I'll come over and babysit more.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Incentive.
Yeah.
See, that's one thing I like about the Switch. I like the ability to be able to just, like, if you want to, you can put it on the big TV, take out the little side things, and hand it over to whoever's with you, and you just play it that way on the big screen. Or if you're on the go, you can just, like, set it down so it kicks in, which actually, those things are pretty good, I feel like. They could be better, but just take off the little side, the little handle things, hand it off, and just play there together. We did that at my wedding, actually.
Yeah, yeah, it actually worked really well. Yeah.
Ultimate gamer wedding.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, there's pre-wedding stuff
set up,
but no, it was
no comment.
I loved it. It was just like, it was nice. If you wanted to play with someone, they wanted to play with you, you could just set it down, take out the little Joy-Cons, hand off your Joy-Con to the other person, and just click two player and race or battle it out or whatever. That's really good job on their end. Bravo to them for that.
I remember the first time I saw two guys at a bar playing Mario Kart on this tiny screen, and it was just perfect. Just like, this is the day and age where it's just so common that they're just like, yeah, we're waiting on our food, and we're just going to like chill and play Mario Kart while we wait. Every plane ride I go on, I've been on two since I got the Switch. I just buy a game because I know I'm invested for at least 3 hours or more, so I'll just get a whole new game and just get completely enveloped in it, play on the headphones, or even like the person sitting next to me, we'll like play Mario Party or something. Like they're sitting right next to me, we're not doing anything for a while.
The only downside is the battery.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Battery sucks.
It's not the only thing that sucks. No, I think that,
follow up.
I don't want to get to the negative stuff right now. I think it's a really well-made piece of kit. I really do enjoy it. I think where it sucks is like Nintendo's like how much is the an extra dock? Like $60?
Yeah, pretty expensive. Like,
for a
set of Joy-Cons, and then is like 70.
Yeah, and then the online experience. Like their online store is still kind of a mess, and it's never really as cheap as like Microsoft Store or PSN Store. The same game can be on sale, and yet it's still way more expensive. And I don't understand why that is.
Why is 3-2-1 Switch still $45?
I don't know. Right? That game probably wasn't supposed to do very well. It didn't do very well, supposedly. I don't know. Anyway, that's not Nintendo's fault. But like, yeah. I mean, I understand that Nintendo first party games don't go on sale because they don't need to go on sale. But I feel like third party games, why do they hold them like? what is the grasp they have on games in stores? Like, any other store is way cheaper than it is on Nintendo, and it's always it's one of those things that keeps me from buying it on the Switch. So it's like, usually games I get are like, I really have to be like, oh man, I could buy Horizon Chase Turbo is a great game. It's this racing car game, super awesome. It was like $10 on PSN the other, and I think what's the cheapest it's been on the Switch store is.
It's only gone down a few bucks.
Yeah, it's like, it just drives me nuts. Like, why can't it be across the board? So that's one, their whole online presence still drives me nuts. And I think Nintendo's just always going to be Nintendo, because Nintendo don't, basically, but I love to.
Yeah, I like right now, I think you can find God of War 4 on PS4 for like 40 or less. I think I've seen it as cheap as $20.
But Odyssey will never go down in price, you know?
No. Yeah, you might see Mario Odyssey at 40, 45 if you're lucky. But it's generally always going to be at 60.
And it'll always go back to 60. I mean, Spider-Man just announced a total price cut of 40. It's at $40 forever now. Yeah. So it's like, they made enough money on it. They're like, we don't need to keep charging people $60 for this game. But Nintendo will never do something like that.
In a couple of years, they'll do their greatest hits line. They always release like the repackaged budget titles. But they'll still be $30-$40. They won't. I don't know what price they usually go at.
I think the cheapest Switch game I've bought was like $29.99, and it was Okami Remake.
Right. Yeah. And a lot of it is not to do with the console itself. I think the console is awesome. I just feel like the way they run the business around the console is kind of infuriating at times. So, I mean, that's kind of how Nintendo's always been.
I have to admit, I'm surprised every single week they have new sales on games.
Sales.
Yeah.
45 cents.
No, they
on
do.
Sale.
They
yeah,
do
but you're
some,
also getting every single mobile game on Switch, too. So it's like kind of maddening there, too. There's not like a, I don't know.
It's hard to find the good stuff. Like Undertale's $10 right now. I've always been curious about the game, so who knows? Maybe I'll jump into it.
Any other thoughts on the system before we get into our lists?
I do love that the indies have a place now, and it's definitely on Switch's eStore. And I mean, there really are like dollar games where you can just, all right, well, this sucks, but I spent $1 on it, so who cares? I think Kuso, I've talked about it in previous shows. It's $2.99. It's a pretty solid game, and hey, like, it goes on sale. I think he had it sale on his birthday for $1. And you can use your Nintendo coins, the weird Nintendo currency that they make up. Every time you buy a game, you get 300 Nintendo coins, which is basically equates to $3.
Well, I think it's dependent on the game.
It's so weird. Yeah, I still
don't. So, like, if you spend an expensive game, you get, like, a more amount of coins. If you buy a cheap game, it's, like, less.
And it doesn't count for sales, too. I think it's, like, I don't know how Nintendo points work. Nobody knows.
It's kind of a weird loyalty program.
Yeah.
And then the loyalty program that I don't get at all is like, then there's the platinum points, which do you no good unless you're on like
3DS.
No, yeah, I guess. I still get those all the time. Like, they just sent me an email and I got some. I was like, what am I going to do with these? I don't know. Anyway.
Yeah, because the My Nintendo store, you can't buy anything for the Switch. It's all for like 3DS or mobile games. So you have the platinum coins and they just kind of sit there unless you want to play
maybe they'll convert
Animal
them
Crossing
at
on
a
your
lower
phone.
At a lower exchange rate.
Yeah, that'd be nice. Trade it for gold coins.
We also talked about how they will inevitably raise the price of Nintendo Online once there actually is a presence.
I'll buy it before it goes up.
But I really like that I did a year plan because...
Right when they release the new Switch that's not no longer a console version, it's just only the portable version, Switch Portable.
The rumored edition.
That's no longer a Switch.
Did you hear
but
about this? I'm new to this too.
What?
Oh, you haven't heard this?
Talk to me.
There's just a lot of rumors that there is a revision Switch of the two. Switch coming, like the Switch 2, but it won't be...
Next summer.
A console version. It'll just be... the handheld version without... I mean, you might be able to connect it to a console just using a cord, but the Joy-Cons won't come off. It'll be all one unit.
Oh, so just...
Oh, so like a cheaper...
Yeah, cheaper version.
They should just improve upon the actual Switch, not make a cheaper version.
They're going to make a cheaper version for kids. That's what's going to happen, I think. That's the last rumor. Yeah. That's the last rumor I heard.
Like the 2DS.
Yeah,
basically,
That doesn't fold.
Because all the jokes were, it's not a Switch anymore, but it'll still be called a Switch. But
Switch U.
Yeah, switch you.
switch you out of your money.
Yeah, they won't be able to snap their fingers at that portable one because the controllers
I
won't
I thought they
in,
would stop
right?
doing that by now, man. I don't get the...
It's
like,
Nintendo.
Oh, they're like, click.
Yeah.
Wait, no, but like in their directs, they do the... But they actually, the Japanese guys, they still do the click.
Yeah.
And it's like...
That sound.
That's why it's their thing, dude. Give them a break.
With who does that? Nobody does that.
They do.
They do.
Duh.
They don't do it in any of their marketing. It's oh my gosh.
They do it in all of their directs. So just let them have their fun.
Reggie never did it.
Well, it's Reggie.
Well, Thanos did it once.
Once.
Yeah.
And that was the end of half of people.
All right, let's talk about some video games. So we want to do our little round robin here, top three games that we think are awesome and you guys should play if you're just getting a Switch or if you haven't gotten these games on a Switch yet. But I would imagine most of us probably have. Well, it depends. Yeah. Anyway, Jared, you can kick us off at number three.
I did my list without any Nintendo like exclusive stuff. I just did things that felt really great to play on the Switch.
Glazeless, I believe you call that.
And go on sale often, so it's really easy to dive in. So my number three is Blaster Master Zero.
Yeah, yeah.
The game is a lot of fun. I guess it was out on 3DS a long time ago, and they ported it to Switch, and it's just a Blaster Master game. There's the 2D sections where you're doing like platforming, running around, and then you go into different dungeon things and your top view, and it's a lot of fun.
How similar is it to the original Blaster Master?
Do you want me to take this?
Go for it.
I played the 8-bit one. That was one of my favorite games. It's been a while. It was the first game I've actually bought with my allowance money.
I just replayed the Blaster one they released it.
It's cleaned up. They still did tribute. They did the original music. They added anime scenes. There's swear words in it. It's a big kids game. It looks
big
great.
Kids.
Yeah.
It looks
and
wonderful.
There's multiple endings. I found out after my first playthrough that you do collect all these little hidden items across the game.
I went through and got the other ending.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's complete tribute to the original with just all these extras, and it looks great on the Switch, too.
Yeah, it does.
The show.
I don't know exactly where it cut out. I'm guessing somewhere maybe at Pokemon. Emily picked Pokemon as her first.
Yeah. And also, sorry, all of my titles are AAA.
That's okay.
But
that's fine.
You should definitely play indie games.
But if you missed any of it, you will be able to download the podcast tomorrow without any breaks. It'll be perfectly wonderful. You can listen to this again if you missed anything. So if there was something you missed, we're going to go to Scott now. And but go to our, you can find us on iTunes and Spotify and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. So anyway, Scott, what is your number three?
Phantasy Star, Sega Ages, remake. Really good graphics, made a game that was awesome into something even better, and I like it.
So they anime, didn't improve the graphics, did they?
Big tits anime?
No, big kids is what you said. It was a big kid game.
Big kid game.
Is the close, yeah, very similar.
The game big tits game. Big game.
I think that's a selling point. I think you should get the game, big tits.
Wait,
what
big
kind
tits.
Of fantasy?
I'm in. No, anyway, that's wrong.
Good game.
This is like just the original now put on Switch, right?
Yeah, with added map, dungeon maps, and they actually tell you what Curver is, which would be abbreviated for like flame armor, and now it actually will tell you if you use the trigger button all the spells what they're actually supposed to be. So Sega actually did release their 30 game collection for whatever, which is just the original game, but this is just specifically Phantasy Star with like a monster compendium, a full magic list, item list. So they don't actually change the game itself. The game stays the same, but these are stupid abbreviations that are like six characters are now fully written out as flame armor.
That's great.
It made an unplayable game playable.
Nice.
Yeah. Cool.
Did you play the original?
I did, and I gave up on it because these dungeon maps required you to do these I think I mentioned in the previous podcast, Fester's Quest level dungeons without
like
any map.
An ant
so you're just grid mapping your progress.
Break out the graphing paper.
Yeah. And there will be like six floors of these 40 square maps, and it's just not fun. So I gave up. I couldn't play any further than maybe the first dungeon. So this is now like a fully playable game.
Cool.
Yeah.
Hey, Scott, can you let us know if they have any comments they want us to say or
they're just saying hi. James Inubito, he just finished his stream. He was playing the Messenger Ninja Gaiden game. He streams at 7:00 Alabama time, so he doesn't conflict with us. I can watch his stream and then come over and play ours. He says the Switch 2, the Switchening. As far as the name. And
very
then
nice.
Nick, who made our awesome Perler, just says, what's up, yo?
Yo.
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 Hi.
Yo. Thank you.
Aaron, number three.
All right. My number three is The Darkest Dungeon Ancestral Edition by Merge Games with
GameStop tag?
Yes. I did buy it from there. It was on sale for 30. Well, on sale, but it was one they're trying to get rid of. But yeah, I bought this a while ago.
Classic GameStop.
That's a cheap game.
That was the first game you bought for the system.
Yes, that is correct. Yeah. Yeah, I got it the day of my Switch purchase, and I like it. I like it because it's unique in a sense, because most games, if you ever get like paralyzed or poisoned or whatever, it's just those few things. This one's like, you can get paralyzed, you can get scared, you can get low morale, you can get almost all the like negative and positive afflictions. Like you can get empowered, you can get enraged.
How many hours of this have you played?
God, I probably played about maybe 4 or 5 hours, and I barely made it to the first dungeon.
So this is
you die a lot in this game, pretty much.
Cool.
And it's like a XCOM, where you can actually like recruit new people. Every time you lose the people, you can bring.
Thank
them back
you for loaning me your copy.
Yeah, yeah, it's a great game. I think you might like it. You might not.
Isn't there a sequel coming out?
I don't know.
I believe so.
Darker, dark. This dungeon.
Yeah, even darker.
More dark dungeon.
Darkerist.
The darkening.
Yeah. Dark dark dungeon.
More
two.
Darkerist.
The darkening.
Maybe going in a different direction. Maybe they're going light dungeon.
Yes.
Do you think about that?
Yeah.
Jeez.
Too bright.
Too bright dungeon. Bright dungeon.
Oh, yeah.
Awesome. Anything else you would like to say about the game?
Yeah. I also like the fact that in this game, your environment actually can hurt you, because like if you go into the dungeon and your lights go out, you cannot fight anything in there because they will kick your ass. This happened to me several times. So you always have to have everything fully stocked and your candles fully ready to go, as you're going to get fucked in the ass by these things.
Mm, that sounds fun.
That sounds painful.
It's like a Wednesday night, really.
I'm glad I'm not here on Wednesday night.
Yeah. But no, it's a great game. I recommend it for anybody who wants a tougher game. We actually have to keep on your toes, make sure everybody's perfectly sane, happy, full, not a pansy.
Not a pansy.
Well, they get scared in this game pretty well, actually.
It sounds like I probably won't like it, but I want to try it.
You should.
So I'm going to borrow it.
Don't take what I say into consideration, but at least try it. It's worth it. It really is.
Yeah, I'll give it a little bit of time. It sounds intriguing, and a lot of people talked really positive about it when it first came out, so I'm interested in that level.
It's really good. It's worth trying, for sure.
All right, so you just bought a Switch. And one of the games I would recommend, you know, this is going to go against, you know, my core beliefs and all that stuff, but I would actually recommend, and many people think I hate this game or this series of games, but I would actually recommend Breath of the Wild. It's a solid, I think I liked it more than Jared, but it's a solid 8 of a game. And it's probably the most epic, like, open world game on the Switch. So, I don't know. I don't have a lot to say about the game. I think it is pretty cool. I think, I don't think it's incredibly inventive like a lot of the critics were saying about the game. I do think it does a lot of things well, but it also does a lot of things I don't think are super great. But I do think it's fun. I do think the puzzles are a lot of fun. And
I just didn't like fighting stuff.
Yeah, the fighting is not fun.
But
everything else was fine. Yeah.
Well, the way the story is given to you, I think, is awful. But
that's just on par with Legend of Zelda games, which I love.
I guess, and that's why I don't like Zelda games.
Yeah.
Because I don't like the way the story is given to you. I think it's just, and
they do
I would
need
think
to
that they.
On that.
Anyway, I'm not trying to shit on this Duggan because I'm recommending this game, Jared. Jesus Christ!
Oh, I know. Go for it.
I had so many games to choose from, and I actually sat down and I like this game. Because people think I hate this fucking game, but I don't. Actually, they think I hate other games, but anyway, I like this game. Anyway, I'm recommending it. Jeez.
Give it a shot.
Number 3 for Ian.
That's my number 3.
Yeah.
Breath of the Wild. I do wish you could play as like a chick or something, like get rid of Link. But anyway,
after you beat the game, you should be able to play as Zelda. That'd be so cool.
That would be awesome, actually.
Yeah. Linkle, come on.
They're definitely gonna make that game at some point.
No,
they have to.
Never. Never.
Linkle, the Legend of Link. Have Zelda save Link, right?
Yeah.
Come on.
That would be great.
Yeah, just bring it.
I mean, I want.
Boots,
I mean,
her a sword and let her go.
Even play as Sheik or something. Just go in the past.
That would be awesome.
Anyway.
I like Sheik.
Or
yes.
The future, whichever. Yeah.
Jared, number 2.
My number 2, if you want a difficult platforming game, Hollow Knight.
Yeah.
I would put on the top of any list. The music, the graphics, gameplay, everything is just wonderful. It feels perfect to play. Yes.
Done well.
And they announced a sequel, so you must be excited.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's going to be interesting. It was just going to be DLC, but it's now just a full-blown, like, big addition.
The art style of that game is crazy cool. Yeah. And I'm not into those type of games, but it's the art style alone is one of those things that kind of makes me want to play it. Didn't you get it digitally, though?
Yes, I did. So I'll never, it goes on sale very often.
Can't share.
So just buy it.
Just buy it. Just buy it. Because I have... Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Jared.
The challenge keeps coming you back because you know, like, you get closer and closer to beating a boss every time you fight it, and you just know it's going to feel good when you finally beat that boss. It's one of those. The boss fights are really cool. I actually watched a lot of a speed run from...
Games Done Quick.
Yeah, Games Done Quick. And just watching the pros go through that, it's like, how do they do this? This game is easy. It's like a walk in the park for them.
Nice.
I don't know if this is a spoiler. I don't want you to spoil it if it is, but is the Hollow Knight the little guy on the front?
Maybe.
Okay. There
you
go.
You fight a Hollow Knight.
All right. No more. Emily, number two.
Number two, I decided to put in a multiplayer game. So Smash Bros.
Ultimate.
Awesome.
I still want to play it.
Smash Brothers all the way. It's so much fun. Can you guess what character I play as?
No
Pikachu.
Way.
Oh, you play Zelda.
Isabel, right?
Yeah, Pikachu.
You play Zelda.
That's Luchadori Pikachu, as you determined, yes. Is a female.
How long?
Yeah, the distinction with my tail.
How long did you have to wait to unlock Pikachu?
Comes standard. Didn't have to unlock. You do have
the
to
original
unlock
eight.
Pichu. And what's really weird is that I think Pichu is bigger than Pikachu.
Mm-hmm.
That just doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
No.
Interesting.
But I think it's really cool how many characters are coming out and all of the DLC that's going to come with the game. And I have not purchased it yet, but I've played it extensively and I want it. And that will probably be our next game.
Get that 20% off at Best Buy.
Yeah,
let's
go for it.
Let's rock the Gamers Club.
Are you a big Smash fan before this game? Or?
Yeah, N64 Smash was my jam.
Yes, mm-hmm. That was a good one.
I did the Wii version. Brawl?
Yeah,
that Brawl?
It was Brawl, yeah. And then the Melee, thing is
Melee
as well.
What was GameCube one?
I think it was Melee.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
right.
Right. That's the one everybody still loves to play because the GameCube controllers.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, that one was nice.
Have you played that with the GameCube controllers on the Switch?
I want to, actually, now that you mention it. I hate using the Switch controller.
Yeah, they have that at Outrage. They have the multi-tap where it's basically GameCube controllers plugged into a hub. And that, I mean, that's the best way in... Probably the way the pros play.
I bought a dongle from 8-Bit Do that I use my PS4 controller. That's how I beat Hollow Knight, is with my PS4 controller.
Yeah.
So
it's
yeah.
just a hub, like a universal.
It's
multi-
just a little.
It was cheap too, right?
Like wireless card. Yeah, it was less than $20.
Nice.
It's a little wireless dongle you put in your system.
And it looks like Mario bricks.
Yeah. It does.
It's
great.
That's
cool. I'll show you next time.
I even played on the $90. Nintendo Switch controller, and it still didn't feel right. Like, the GameCube controller is just
the
so
Pro
pure.
Controller?
Yeah.
You can get that like $50 now, I think.
I don't see the reason to drop $90 on that.
That's what he got. That's why I told Jared to get... Jared was like, hey, Jared, you should just get this. And he's like, okay, I'll check it out.
And playing Hollow Knight, you have to be very precise. I didn't notice a delay or anything like that. It works flawlessly.
Good.
That's
cool. Yeah, so I'll link that to you.
Mm-hmm.
Are you good at Smash, or you just... It's a
I
fun...
I mean, I'm not, like, going to enter the championship.
But
you
beat all us.
But
probably.
I beat
probably.
Quite
I
a thought. Bit of your friends when we played.
So she's good.
Yeah,
we had a get-together where we were all just unlocking characters, and that really is the big joy of it, of every, 10 minutes you're challenged by another person you unlock, challenged by another person you unlock. So the first run-through is for sure the best, because you don't know who's coming... In that shadow, you don't know who's about
the
to...
The anticipation was like, a new challenger
appears.
Yeah,
that's cool.
I was like, fuck, I have to beat it.
Yeah. Hand the controller to someone who's good with Zelda.
Yeah.
All
right, Scuddy.
I'll say Mario Odyssey.
You'll say it, but you won't commit to it?
All right. So, yeah, when we did
you
tops...
You very convincing.
I wasn't convincing enough. It was definitely a throwback to old Mario games. All the hidden secrets. Like, you don't want to... jump to the next planet and play the next stage. You want to complete and get every single coin, and I liked it. The final battle was such a throwback of like 8-bit, and I mean Mario, Bowser, Princess. The music's really good. It's just a solid Mario game. It's the Mario game that we wanted.
It's one of my favorites. Yeah, it's great.
And they actually throw back the Mario 64 level in that game.
Nice.
So you're playing the original stage, the original castle, with of course Yoshi up top.
Yeah.
In the new one, it just it brought back memories.
Nice. And then it's kind of cool because when you go in the castle at the top of the hill, it actually plays the music from the N64 castle. Mm-hmm. So that's really cool. Awesome.
Their DLC has been pretty solid too. They kind of trickle in little, they had like a zombie hat that you wear. They had astronaut outfits. So they're constantly adding a little
costumes,
bit.
Costumes, but not actual levels though.
But they had it's a mode else. Where Luigi came in and he has balloons that you can hide.
That's right, yeah.
Was this before he died?
Yeah, before Luigi died in Smash Brothers.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's a mode to hide balloons, and you get points for how long it takes people to find them, I think. Something like that.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
I never tried it, but maybe,
I tried
maybe
it
someday.
And people get devious with, like, there's a water level where you have to swim super fast, then go up, and then, like, bounce off some things, and that's where Luigi's balloon is at. So it's like out of the 2-minute time limit you get, they basically ran or swam as far as possible. So you're racking up points for people attempting your level. So it's kind of like you create a stage, a super challenge for other people to play. And then it changes. It's always a different one.
Early on, people were hiding it inside of buildings that they knew how to get in.
Oh, yeah. They're clipping, like wall clipping and making it cool. So you physically cannot get to it unless you like jag through the wall.
That's super fair.
Yeah, totally fair.
Sounds totally fair.
Cool. Mario Odyssey. Scott's number two. Aaron.
Let's stick with Mario.
What's your...
My number two is we're going to Mario Land again. Only this time it's in the racing format. Mario Kart 8 Deluxe Edition. This game is really fun. I like playing with people. I like playing by myself. I like playing at nighttime. I like playing it in daytime. And pretty much it's.
Do you like playing it when you're driving?
No. No. I just like playing it. It's fun.
I like playing Mario Kart when I'm drunk, though, because then it's like you're doing drunk driving, which you should never do in real life.
Yeah, don't endorse drunk driving.
But
don't
when you're playing driving. Mario Kart drunk, you can turn on the mode where you can't drive off the edge.
Yes, you can. Yep. The rails are on, yeah.
Yeah, put the rails on. It's like bowling.
Exactly.
Gutter bumpers.
It's fun, though. I love it.
It's perfect if you have kids, too, because my daughter can play it, and it will keep you on the road.
Yeah.
And it will accelerate for them if they forget to hit the button or whatever. So they'll be able to keep going. And have fun with it.
Yeah. Did previous Mario Karts had that?
Not that I recall.
I don't remember.
I didn't play it on the Wii U, and it wasn't on any of the ones before that.
Too much glaze on that game for me, boys.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. That's okay.
The first Mario Kart will always be my favorite.
Oh Super
that
Nintendo?
One is great.
That's great.
That one's first, and then this one I feel like is second.
I like how the Super Nintendo battle mode is in the
that's
kind of
cool.
Kart.
I like that.
Yeah,
I like the throwback to all the level. Other. I like the throwback to all the other levels of Mario Kart in here,
Rainbow
too. Like
Road. Rainbow Road. It's on the cover.
Rainbow Road's on. Well, they have like several of them in this one.
It's
cool.
It's crazy.
Kind of a nightmare on some of those, but no.
Yeah.
And Waluigi's in it. I'm happy.
Yeah. But that's my number two.
Yeah, cool.
Sometimes I'm amazed that I have a Switch because...
You're not a Nintendo fan, but you're more interested in the hardware.
Anyway. Anywho. I just don't like kart racing games in general, I think. I don't know.
Maybe Crash Team Racing.
I don't know. My number two is... it's a console exclusive, but it is on PC. From the guys that brought us FTL, I put Into the Breach is my number two strategy game. I think this game is super awesome. Quick games, jump in, play it, jump out. I think it's really inventive and smart. The level of depth in the game is super cool. I've talked about the game before. It's like an old school XCOM type game, but I really like the choices they give you and the simplicity of it. I don't know. It's just something about it that I think is super cool. I don't really think I need to talk about it anymore, but it's a cool game. If you don't, it's usually pretty cheap. Into the Breach. I forget the developer's name.
Mm-hmm. Fear the Light, or what's the... Well, that's the other game they made.
FTL is the other game.
Which, according to the guy on the plane, said it's better, but yeah.
Isn't it? Well, that's fine. I mean, no, Faster Than Light.
Faster Than Light.
Faster Than Light is a super popular game and was around for a long time, and this is their second game, but this game was still like on a bazillion game of the year lists.
Yeah.
So it's like a super good
game. Yeah, Metacritic, it's like 4.8 or something.
It's crazy awesome. Yeah. So nice. I still recommend it heavily. So if it's on sale, just pay. I bought it for like $7, so I got it pretty cheap. But
mm-hmm. Nice.
Because I never tried Fast FTL, yeah. And those XCOM games, while I kind of like them, I'm not ever really into them. But this one is like, it doesn't, you don't have to sit down and play like for a half hour. It's like a 5-minute match. Oh, I'll do that again. And okay, oh, I lost. I'll put it away and then I'll come back to it. And you just, I don't know. I think it's super cool.
Sounds like it should be Dave's first game.
It's perfect. It's like, it's just like a really cool, like simple, like a tabletop game, really.
Yeah, quick matches sound nice because, yeah, that's one of the many reasons I didn't keep playing XCOM.
And then just the way it's really complex, though super simple. I just really like the level of, like, oh, if I hit this guy, he's going to go into this thing and kill that. And it's just, like, kind of smart. It's just really smart. Those guys make smart games. So, anyway, Into the Breach. And mechs! Who doesn't like mechs?
Mecha.
Mechs are cool.
Number one!
Yeah,
calling number one!
My number one, I was showing off a little bit of it earlier, is Yoku's Island Express. It's a very fine platforming game.
Pinball. It combines pinball.
Yeah.
And platforming.
Yeah, because your character can't jump. He's a dung beetle that's, toes his ball around. It's not actual poop, don't worry. but the only way you can jump up in the world is with pinball paddles. And throughout the game, there are like bigger pinball table-esque type sections, and they're really well done, and sometimes they're even like
it's like an enemy or something you have to fight too, or you have to keep hitting him, or
like boss fights. Sometimes it'll be like several pinball tables kind of combined to be one, so you can figure out puzzles. And it's really cool. The characters that they created for the game are really awesome, and there's a story that you get to play through. So
the music's really cute.
Yeah, it's very, very and awesome game. It's not only on Switch, so you can buy it anywhere, but it felt perfect on the Switch.
Yeah. And if you like, I don't know, it reminds me of Little Big Planet in the sense where, like, anything, the little prizes or little things pop out, they go pop, 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 pop. Yeah. Like all the little balloons would in Little Big Planet. It has this very, like, just...
It's very cute, adorable game.
But it also makes you feel like you're always winning something.
Yeah.
Like pinball, I guess. I don't know. It just, it's cool.
Well, there's, like... If you want to get into like the deep game of it, on the big tables, there's like after you master that section, you get like a scarab that will knock out an item that you have to collect to 100% the game.
Nice.
So it has the advanced level of stuff that you can do. There's a lot of collectibles if you want to finish everything in the game. So it can be as deep as you want it to be, or just kind of mash through it real fast.
It's an honorable mention of mine.
Yeah.
All right. Emily, number one.
Number one would have to be Breath of the Wild. I really enjoyed that game. I think I've put in 130 hours.
No,
of
more
game.
Than that.
Dang.
You can actually see.
Oh, yeah, it's like 156.
You can actually look and see how many hours people... 236.
Oh, thank you. I couldn't remember.
Holy crap.
And that was like a month or two ago that I checked just to see, and it was impressive.
I've gone to all of the temples, or whatever they're called, shrines. I've gone to all the shrines. I've gotten the motorcycle.
Yeah.
The only thing I haven't done on it is like the hardest level of the hero mode for your Master Sword.
She jumped on the season pass.
Yeah.
Day one. So all
I got
DLC.
All the things for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that game, super nostalgic, and also the third game that I mentioned, Pokemon, I cried in both of them. I just really love the storyline. It's so beautiful, and the open world is everything that I could want in a Zelda game that I didn't know I wanted. The only thing that I didn't like is I wanted more romance between Zelda and Link.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's what everybody's always wanted since Legend of Zelda started.
Excuse me, princess.
Yeah, yeah, geez.
You get to the end of the game, you're like, okay, now kiss.
Yeah,
and
just
they
do
don't.
Something.
I don't even think they hugged. I can't remember.
No, they never touch each other.
They
it's
never
annoying.
Touch. They're about to, and then poop.
Yep.
Over.
It's like Zelda's about to fall over something. Link will step to the side. Can't touch you.
I think there was more of a romantic storyline in Skyward Sword than any other Zelda title.
That's one of the only ones I've never played.
Mm. That's good.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe they'll remaster it or something.
Yeah.
Someday.
I would Google it and Switch.
Yeah, there's a lot of games I wish they'd just remaster. Like you were talking Mario Galaxy earlier, and Skyward Sword, and all kinds of stuff.
You got Awakening coming out.
Yeah, nice. I want that.
26-year-old remaster, about time.
Yeah, I've always been a fan of Legend of Zelda. I don't know why Breath of the Wild just didn't stand out to me. I mean, it looks wonderful. Just the old school battle system, I think, is just what just threw me aside. I just couldn't get used to it. Yeah, that's the sound
the targeting you get used to. I don't think the targeting works particularly well, in my opinion.
They kept the targeting from Ocarina of Time. They haven't updated it since then. And it's obnoxious.
Yeah, it sounds
and
like it.
And they needed to change that so bad.
I think I would. I think,
but
I didn't,
the game's great.
I haven't quite finished it. The thing that the targeting system is one thing, but I wish that the big the creatures,
legends,
the guardians,
whatever.
Once you can finally kill them, it's amazing.
Oh well, yeah.
I just no, just the not so that rewarding. the animals, big animals, the
goblins.
No,
oh, the like stone people.
Yeah, the big like there's the elephant and there's the iguana thing.
Oh no,
the world creatures.
Yeah, the beasts, the divine beasts.
The divine beasts.
Yeah.
That's what it is. I wish you just had to solve it as a puzzle and then didn't have to fight the bullet sponge at the end. Like, oh, I solved this puzzle. Why do I have to fight this weird thing that just I don't know? Like it takes a million arrows or I don't know.
I think I would like that game a lot more without enemies. I would probably still be playing it if it didn't have enemies. It's just like a wonderful puzzle game because they introduced a lot of really cool puzzle concepts into the Legend of Zelda series, and that is its high point.
I feel like at the end I'm just like throwing a sword at them and then running to go pick it up and then throwing a sword at them or something, and yeah. It's just like, I didn't come here equipped, which is like true with but I feel like most RPGs I can find a way to easily defeat the boss, and I feel like in that game I just felt like, oh my god, I really have to prepare for this, and this is like I don't want to do this.
You better cook your food before you
yeah, right, you got a cooking game.
No,
fishing.
Yeah, anyway. But I still really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Even though I haven't quite completed it. But oh well.
You should.
Do it.
He has it on the Wii U, so he can't bring it with him.
No.
Poor guy.
You're right. I'm recommending the game I played on Wii U. Maybe I would have beat it.
Just
on
borrow Aaron's copy when he's done with it.
Your copy? Oh, wait, you gifted it to him. Never mind.
Yeah, yeah, wedding. I gave it to him for his wedding.
I guess I could throw something on there because you also got the Zelda Dynasty Warriors game.
Hyrule Warriors.
Yeah.
You're gonna throw? Not even does it even rank?
You get to play as Linkle?
Is it Linkle? You can play as Linkle. And it was for the Wii originally?
That's
Wii U.
So,
yeah. No, it was a Wii U game. It was a Wii U game.
Wii U.
Hyrule Warriors, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Wii U, what's the difference?
Why, were you a Samurai Warriors fan?
Well, no, she got it.
I used to play Dynasty Warriors.
Oh, Dynasty Warriors?
Yeah,
okay.
That's a good one.
Okay.
Did you watch the OC as well?
Mm-mm.
Oh, because I used to play that all the time.
Funny.
I love the OC, so.
Detour.
Number one, Scott?
Celeste. So it was multi-platform, and I explained my reason in really liking the whole Mountain of Depression, and the game's timing was really bittersweet. I thought it belongs on the Switch. Like, the Switch is great for these pixely-looking games, and to have it handheld. You can crack it right on the mic, too.
Yeah. That's acceptable.
It's acceptable, yeah.
I highly recommend the game. I did actually order the limited run PS4 one because I just want to play through and get a full platinum on it. But beating it on Switch was good too. The more hidden things you find at the end, you bake a pie, and your pie gets better if you collect more hidden stuff. So it was kind of cool seeing that. I went back and got 10 more little cherries for the cherry pie at the end, and it becomes like a cake.
I do want to play that someday.
I'll let you borrow it. Yeah, for sure.
Oh, okay.
It's a solid game, and I think it's gone down in price since it came out.
I have it in my wish list for the Switch, and it hasn't gone down once.
Okay, well,
not since I've been watching.
I think it was on sale last week on PS4.
Because it was like top rated or something. I think all those went on sale super cheap. Number one, just because it's a solid game. The soundtrack's so good. I think I told you too that I was just like, I really like the soundtrack. I think I'm just gonna get the game because the soundtrack alone was enough to.
I have a question separate from because you like this game so much and because what it means to you. Is this game like anywhere on your top 10 of all time? Like, does this crack any kind of like?
I actually went through my top 50 that I wrote a decade ago, and I've been like kind of reorganizing it. Yeah, Celeste is up there.
I would like to see that list.
Like yeah, on in yeah, the 10 that, or like not one. Quite?
It's a top 50. So I did have to like shuffle some things down. Like I took a lot of care in this. Actually put release dates and company and
What fell off of your top 50?
I think like one of the Dance Dance Revolutions took like a step down.
Oh, okay, that's yeah. all right.
Praise be.
But it's hard. It's hard
glory
to take
to mankind.
That tune. It's hard to push a game out of your top 50 because I mean it made my top 50 10 years ago. Why is it not still on there? So yeah, Celeste and Nier were added recently.
Nice.
Cool.
Yep.
Aaron, number one.
My number one is a little game that's also available for PS4 and
the Blue
Xbox
Bomber.
One. It is Mega Man 11 for the Switch. That game, it is the one of the more, it's like the other ones, frustrating as hell. Controls are pretty easy.
Have you beat this yet?
I got 3 bosses left to beat on that thing.
I thought you said two last time.
No, I thought I had one left.
All right, you're getting there.
Yeah, I got there. I'm getting there. Just the final 3 levels are so fucking hard. Like one of them is like a giant bouncy room you have to bounce all over the place in, and that's, you have to coordinate with all the stuff you have and make sure you get all the right angles, or you're not going to get up to the next portion of the level. But no, that game is so fun. It really is. If you liked the Mega Man, that's not the Legend series. That's for like, Dreamcast.
Close.
Yeah. No, if you don't like that one, this game's actually right up your alley. It's frustrating. It's fun. It's anger inducing. It's just great.
Do you like it more than Mighty No. 9?
Yes.
Did you play Mega Man X?
Yes.
Back in the day, does it feel anything like that? Did they have wall jump and dash or anything like that?
No.
No. Okay. That's what I'm thinking. I might pick up the Mega Man X Legends Collection.
Yeah.
Or whatever they call that, because they have a collection of those, and they were so great. I would like to try Mega Man 11 though.
One of the cool things about this game though is you can buy parts for your person. That kind of, I don't think you can do that in the X series, but you can buy like parts you permanently attach to your person. Like you can buy like traction for your shoes and the ice levels, and you can buy auto charge where like automatically powers up your X Buster.
Okay, just little upgrades. In Mega Man X, you just find a new suit. I forgot what
helmet
it did.
And
oh yeah,
boot,
that
helmet,
was
boots,
awesome.
And your torso or whatever. Yeah, that was rad. Making yourself look different. I mean, it's cool that they introduced that kind of thing into Mega Man 11. I played 9 and 10 on the PS3 because they gave them. I think they gave them
for free.
Free.
Yeah, I ran through them. Or no, I tried to play.
Yeah,
them.
I played the first
game
of
like,
those once.
I can't get through.
They're made to be like.
That made
bone crushing.
So,
yeah.
And I think I'm on the second easiest mode too. That's what makes
it has difficulties. Okay.
Yeah, you can go from easy. It goes easy up to very hard. And I think you have to unlock hard, beat hard to get the very hard, and very hard to extreme, which is like no
one hit kill.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Right. Yeah. Jeez. No thanks.
No, thank you. I'm good.
But yeah. I liked Mega Man a lot back in the day.
It's solid. I definitely recommend it. It's definitely right there. Play it.
Oh, there's a demo available, I think, on Switch and PS4, probably PlayStation Xbox One. So if you're interested in Mega Man 11, try it out.
Yeah, give it a
Boulder Man stage. And it's a solid stage to get introduced to the super abilities.
So Rockman has to fight Boulder Man?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're running out of names.
Not Paper Man?
Yeah.
No Paper Man. Scissor Man?
Cut Man is Scissor Man. What'd you say?
I was like Rock, Paper, Scissor, Scissor Man.
Then there's Bounce Man and Blast Man. And other, and
someone needs to kickstart like a naughty version of Mega Man where it's like Fart Man and Puke Man. And
I'm sure it's been done somewhere.
Butt Man.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, or just look on
Booger Man.
Some PC forums. I'm sure somebody's made something.
That has
to be. But I mean like a serious like good game that has all this really like bizarre shit in it. Anyway,
it's gonna probably come down the line somewhere.
Couch Man.
Like you know, poop trumps like what. Trump. I don't know. Anyway, Trump. Anyway.
Milkman.
Milk. No. Milkman is not funny.
Oh.
Are you done, Aaron?
Yeah.
All right.
I was done a second ago. Then we got on this tangent.
Yep. Tangents are okay.
I'm fine with it.
Tangent. Okay. My number one. The reason I bought a Switch, but the game's not out yet, so I had to go with its the one that came before it. Bayonetta 2.
Which you played on the Wii U.
I also played on the Wii U, but it's obviously the version, pretty much the same version is available.
I have the Switch version.
On the Switch. I bought a Switch for the eventual release of Bayonetta 3. I love Bayonetta 2 a lot. It's a great game. I love Platinum games, so, and it's an exclusive to the Switch, nice. Or the Nintendo, basically. And I don't know what to say about this game. The combat's super fun. The character's over the top. The story's a little hokey and crazy, but I love that Japanese craziness.
Yeah, that's what I love about it, is the story is just super crazy.
There's some pretty childish, not childish, but just like, you know, juvenile humor, obviously.
Well, like the levels where you're falling and falling and falling, but you're still like jumping from building to building that are just plummeting down the hillside. That kind of stuff's really cool.
But it's just really solid gameplay. And the best of its kind, I think. Yeah. And that's why I also think why Nier is so good. I think that's why Nier Automata is better than the first Nier, because the combat is better.
That was so
way
tight,
better.
That game.
But anyway, Bayonetta 2, awesome game. It's my number one.
Great game.
Nice.
You know, Bayonetta.
And she's sexy.
Yeah, I was going to say that's the one with like the very voluptuous, crazy, over the top.
Oh, yeah.
Over
the
top. She's not wearing technically clothes. She's wearing her hair. She does like these. She's a witch. She does like she casts like spells and her hair comes off and creates like a monster or a dragon or something.
Yeah, pretty epic stuff.
Didn't they base her look on Sarah Palin, the glasses, and that was a rumor maybe.
Yeah, yeah, that was funny. So, but and then the cool thing about the Nintendo version is that then you can dress up as Link,
Peach.
Yeah, you could be Peach
Samus
and
in a power suit.
The Luigi princess.
Daisy.
Yeah, you could be Daisy, and man, those were naughty.
They're all naughty versions. It's all, but it's cool. Like in the Metroid one, when you turn into the ball and you can roll around, and it does all kinds of crazy shit. So it's kind of cool. Like when you're doing the Zelda version, or you know, when you hit things, it does the coins, and the coins make the coin sound. It's really smart.
That's cool.
It's really cool.
The
cause
rupees,
it's exclusive to that console, so it's kind of smart.
Get it straight.
Get it right.
I wonder in that version with her hair, it's a chickens that fly out of it.
Oh my god.
The cool thing too is if you buy the new with Bayonetta 2, you get Bayonetta 1 for free.
Yep.
Nice.
Bayonetta 1 was obviously on multiple platforms, but it's also a really good game. So
PS3, Xbox 360.
Yeah. And PC,
maybe
I believe.
I don't know.
I think so.
I've been meaning to check that out.
Anyway,
you should.
Bayonetta is a lot of fun. I think it's a great character. It's a great game. Anyway, yeah. Any last thoughts as we wrap up this
honorable mentions? We doing that?
We can do. Yeah. We can throw out some honorable mentions.
Tetris 99 was just a slap in the face with all the massive battle shooters, and now it's just like
where you're dropping,
a puzzle
bro.
Game.
Where you're dropping?
Yeah. It's just intense. It gets. Man, I've hit six. When you hit those higher numbers, it just gets so insane. The music gets nuts.
I got to four. That was the highest I've ever made.
Is it like crack cocaine, though? You hit it, and then you're like, oh, my God, I got
to
keep
going. Let's hear this pro tip.
No,
you told me the pro tip on getting that. You turn the music off.
Oh, yeah, turn the music off for sure. It's too distracting. But it's not like a hardcore drug because I need to be able to take a break. I would love a pause button, but it's live, so you can't pause. So you're like forced to like watch it and complete the game.
Don't blink.
There are like people trying to talk to you and interact, and you're like, no, I'm playing a game, shut up. So
do you guys find that like
100% attention
about like a half hour in, that's where you're primed and ready to do your, or do you guys like good right out of the gate? You gotta like
I
play
think
for
I'm,
like
I'm quicker on my
think, like three rounds
up.
And then I'm starting to get good,
yeah,
and then I'll probably play for like an hour tops, and then I have to like
people are noticeably getting better too. Like I didn't even realize you could choose who you're attacking. I mean, you mentioned
you
can add the attacker and stuff.
Oh.
The first time I just did random. I feel like
you can do randoms.
Hello,
you can totally switch until
I don't have time to look at that.
Yeah,
screen.
Right. It's nuts.
And people are selectively targeting you. Like you will all of a sudden, you're being attacked by.
And you should be able to tell who is doing you too. But it's things are happening so fast.
You don't have the time
to. But like some people like they can see it. It's like, oh, that guy's being annoying to me.
Yep. Yeah, so that
honorable mention.
Yeah, honorable mention. And well worth Nintendo Online subscription.
Nice.
Yes.
Yeah.
I would like to make an honorable mention because I did all AAA titles, but I am very pro indie game. I don't know if any of you guys know Pig Squad, the Portland Indie Game Squad, but those guys just made a game that is available for Switch. It's called The World Next Door.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really cool. It's a strategy puzzle game. It's got a little like story character development type thing going on. Really cute, awesome characters, really fun puzzle game. Check it out.
They made up a language for it.
Like little rune symbols.
Yeah,
or something.
I mean, there's elves in it and things like that. The game finally got a release date, I think last week of March, late March or something like that.
Yeah.
I applied as a possible Steam download to play the game early, so hopefully we get clearance on that, but that'd be really cool to review it. And it is green lighted. It's definitely coming out to Switch. And hey,
what's the game called?
Local
again?
The World Next Door.
Okay.
Check it out.
By Rose City Games.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Cool. I have a couple. Jared or Aaron mentioned Horizon Chase Turbo. That was, it's a great racing game if you want something a little more racing and less kart racing.
Yeah.
It's a lot of fun.
It's a great game. It looks really cool. Has some fun. It's cool, like electronic music, and you can play it 4-player, split screen co-op.
It's like updated Rad Racer.
Yeah, basically updated Rad Racer.
You do know it's based on a Super Nintendo game called Top Gear, right?
Isn't it Outrun?
Top Gear.
I thought it was Outrun.
The first stage music is remixed in that game. Immediately when I started playing it, I remembered that. But you also have Turbo and you have sharp turns and stuff. So I think it is the same studio. They just cleaned it up, but it's. Yeah, Top Gear for Super Nintendo.
Great. I don't think it's the same studio because this studio is from down south.
Let's research that.
They're down in like Central America, South America.
It's a solid game. I like it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice. And then I'm gonna recommend Warframe because
it's free.
It's amazing. It's free. You don't need Nintendo Online, and it's amazing. This game runs on the Switch, and I don't know. Yeah. I think it's a lot of fun.
It looks
really good. Plays really well. So I'm gonna keep.
We talk about that like every month at least once.
Warframe.
You said it was a 64 gig game compressed down to 13 gigs on Switch, and it still looks amazing.
Something crazy like that.
Well, now it's like 27
all
gigs. It's pretty big. So make sure you have space on your card.
Yeah.
I believe every Switch needs to have Pinball FX3 on it.
Mine has it.
Yeah.
I also have the Portal table.
Yeah, okay, I didn't buy that. But I think you get a couple of free tables with the Switch version, so you don't have to buy anything into it. It's a free-to-play game for that reason. But all the tables, of course, you can buy. There's bundles for different ones. They just acquired the Williams pinball table license, so they have a lot of Williams ones. So, yeah, cool. That's building. They even have, like, movie ones and game ones. Like, there's Doom. There's Aliens versus Predator, I think, is on there.
Cool.
There's a Jaws one, I think there was. I mean, there's a lot of crazy ones. So,
I believe it.
Pinball. Everybody loves pinball to some degree.
Yeah. Good pinball games out there.
Yeah.
Anything?
Yeah, it's fun to have for free.
You want to recommend the other game you've played on the Switch, Aaron?
No.
What was that?
It was like Dawn, Rise of the Breakers or something like that. I can't remember.
Oh, right, that free game.
Yeah. That's not worth it. No. But I will, you mentioned it earlier as your number one. Emily mentioned as her number one is Zelda Breath of the Wild. It's definitely, I didn't play enough to formulate opinion, but it's good to at least try and check it out. It's definitely worthy.
Did your wife beat it?
No.
No? Okay. Yeah, I know she really wanted it.
Yeah. She didn't mean to sit down and play. I've just been busy with stuff.
Speaking of Zelda, there's another one that I would recommend if you're waiting for your Link's Adventure or Link's Awakening. There's a game on the system. It's always pretty affordable. It's called Blossom Tales. And it's pretty much that style of game.
Link to the Past style.
Yeah, it's a wonderful game. The map's really good. The colors are really good. I like the character that you use. And the only complaint I had about it is it doesn't have the smooth scrolling between windows when you're like moving between panes, throughout the world. So it just like goes black and then appears in the next one.
Did they ever just hint at Zelda? Like they're like, oops, I meant to say Hyrule. Oops.
No.
There's
got to
be some nods that are just
I mean, it's obviously that style of game. So, I mean, I don't recall any specific jokes about it, but it's great.
Can you attack chickens in it?
I don't recall.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah. It's.
I would hope you could.
That's one of the first games I bought on my Switch, so it's been like a year and a half, something like that. But do it. It's good.
Yeah.
Blossom Tales.
Woo.
All right. I got your info. So it wasn't developed by the same team.
Yeah.
But Barry Leech.
Oh, the
he's the composer of the new game, and he did the music for the original game.
That's cool.
And that buried in the soundtrack, I guess, he proposed to his wife.
Wow.
Or longtime girlfriend.
Cute.
That's cool.
Anyway, yeah.
I hope it worked out.
This game was, Horizon Chase Turbo was developed by Aquarius, and Top Gear was developed by...
Ocean or something.
It was published by Kemco and developed by Gremlin Graphics.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Take that, Scott.
It's possible, though, that it's possible that some of those people were moved down south. I don't know.
Oh yeah, developers move everywhere.
Start
new company.
The game is considered a genre of Sega Core. There's a genre of games called Sega Core.
Huh?
Yeah, right.
I have never heard this term.
That's what they're saying here.
That's research. That's funny.
Research this. Okay. Sega Core.
Sega.
Oh, I mean, they had a lot of racing stuff back in the day.
Yeah.
So maybe that's it. They still have racing games.
Daytona.
Sega Rally.
Anyway.
All that kind of stuff.
You can look at that for another time. But anyway, what are we at here? We should probably wrap. You got any kind of co-optional stuff you guys want to recommend? Anything you cast co-optional, where we get to recommend something other than video games that you've been into, a book, some music, a movie, television.
Oh, yeah. I just started watching, I finished it, The Umbrella Academy on Netflix. That was really good. If you like, isn't it from Dark Horse Comics, I think?
Yeah, Gerard Way of My Chemical Romance, the lead singer.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is like, what, 10 years ago-ish? How long ago was this?
I did not know that. That's crazy.
Not 10 years. It's like 8 years ago. He did some sketches and then and this pitch, and then he went to Dark Horse and they paired him with Gabriel Ba. At the time, Gabriel Ba had done Matt Fraction's. I'm sorry, I can't remember the comic, but it was a big comic then. So anyway, yeah.
Yeah, fingers crossed that there's gonna be a season 2.
There is I do know there's quite a lot of comics in the run of Umbrella Academy, so they have room to do more. So.
Yeah. I will probably start reading the comics now.
Is it a short watch? How many episodes?
Each episode is an hour long, and there are 10 episodes.
That's not bad for...
Kind of a standard Netflix.
Yeah, I think 10 episodes.
Yeah.
I went to Firefest. Firefest PDX. So in light of the super popular Firefest Netflix and Hulu documentaries, they themed it with overpriced drinks that weren't actually that overpriced. They like said $500 champagne, but it was only like $10.
And then said, hey, the only way you can get in is sucking my friend off here.
Yeah.
We really just had to give him candy.
They actually had the sandwiches with two slices of cheese and an accompanying salad with no sauce.
FEMA tent cabanas.
Oh, man, it was great.
That's funny.
It was super popular. It actually went really well for a Wednesday night at Tube downtown. So they're going to do an MTV-themed event, and I'm excited to see where it goes. They said, thanks for coming. And
are you dressing up as Carson Daly then?
Oh, I could. Kurt Loder.
Is it an MTV back when they did music?
Yes.
Theme? Okay.
Yeah, it's no Teen Mom stuff.
Beavis and Butthead?
MTV DJs and DJs and all that. So
okay.
I'm excited to see what they do next. It's just like a goofy, fun, just let's get stupid.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
90s, baby. Woo.
Also, I went to see the Troll Bridge, which apparently Portland has one. And it's a bunch of treasure trolls nailed to this wooden bridge up in
Skaboose.
That's
not creepy.
Litter.
That's not creepy at all.
Yeah.
Litter.
You have to nail them. Otherwise, they come back and get you, so...
But what if they just pop off on their own? They're like, fuck this. Going after you.
Industrial nails.
Well, I saw the picture that you submitted. Yeah. There were some people that drew them on the fall.
Yeah, there's
the
fence. There's some troll art. It's under a wooden bridge.
Okay. It just reminds you of that.
Tracks.
It just reminds you of that Island of the Dolls thing I see in Mexico, only with troll dolls, and there's a bridge in Portland instead of some weird island in Mexico for it.
Do you know about...
No, I'm going to have to Google that.
Yeah.
Litter.
It's a creep. It's allegedly a haunted place in somewhere
Troll
in Mexico.
Island.
Doesn't Seattle have like a place where people just stick
it's
gum
a giant
to the wall or something?
Yeah. Well, there's a troll under
There's also
the
a troll underneath the mark.
They took that down. I think the gum wall is gone now, isn't it? Or is it?
Last I read it, they were getting
once
they
it appeared
it.
In
I didn't see it in Seattle
infamous
when I was there.
Second Son, I think.
Did they have the gum wall in that game?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Huh, I did not know this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody posted it on Kotaku, I think.
Good find.
Hmm. Anything, right. Aaron?
Well, I do. It's more of a place to eat whenever you're taking a break from gaming. It's a place my wife and I...
Chipotle.
No, it's called Dickie's Barbecue.
Taco
they
Bell.
Have No. This is a place called
Nacho Dick's. Fries are back.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Dickies.
All good options. It's a part, but
basically he said, go fuck yourself, is what he said right there.
All my good options. But no, this is barbecue spot. My wife and I just found Dickies Barbecue. And they're all over the place, apparently. There's like at least 20 different spots all over the United States. But you just have to look it up online where your nearest one is. Their barbecue is so good. And it's so affordable. Try their brisket. It's fucking off the hook. Their mac and cheese is good. Everything on the list I've tried is you can't lose. Just go there one night, fucking pull the trigger and get some barbecue.
Is that the one by the airport?
There's one in Tannisbourne. There's one in off of Beaverton and Beaverton area. It's off of Shoals Ferry and Murray, but I think there's one in that area too. But it's just try it out. I think there's also a couple in Washington somewhere in Vancouver. But
oh my.
Just if you ever get a chance, just go.
Yeah, if yourself. We have any Texas listeners, you have plenty of barbecue. You don't need to go to Dickies.
Yeah, that's true.
Our, stick our to PAX your audience, Texans.
Yeah,
hopefully
that's true. But if you don't, just try these guys out. They're worthy of going to. I like their stuff. I love a good barbecue place.
Yeah.
I'm gonna shout out Jason, 8-Bit Brewing. Obviously, none of you guys, unless you're living in Finland, can have his beer.
Yeah,
but you can follow him on Instagram and Facebook, 8-Bit Brewing. He's video game inspired beers, I guess.
Yes.
Ocarina of Lime, Resident Evil,
yes.
Pac-Man Porter. He's got all kinds of different beers.
He's great in Portland.
All of them are good.
He would be great in Portland, but he left Portland to go be in Finland with his wife. Mm-hmm. And so he's up there and he's making it happen up there. Hopefully someday the brewery will go worldwide.
Over here.
He'll come back home. But we've had a couple of the beers. Yeah. We haven't had all the beers on his staple because some of them were created in Finland. But yeah. I remember
most of them we had in his garage.
Yeah.
Yeah, back in the, sometimes back if you watch the opening of the video, you'll see us drinking beer. It's probably Ocarina of Lime or something. But
yeah,
That was that's like his first one, I think. Really.
Yeah.
First
one.
One of his first.
Anyway, I'm gonna recommend 8-Bit Brewing. Hopefully we have a listener in Finland aside from Jason that will maybe go check out 8-Bit Brewing or at least check him out on the social networks and share this stuff and try and somehow help him get more known. I'm going to use our little bit of power to help him get a little bit more power. So 8-Bit Brewing. Jared, you got anything?
I got nothing.
Jared, don't do nothing.
I've just been hanging out. I haven't done anything. I haven't watched any shows.
No,
I'm super
Dragon
boring.
Pants.
No, I haven't even gotten to start Dragon Prince Season 2.
Yeah.
But wow. Thanks for letting me mention it, because I really want to watch it.
Cool.
That's what I'm here for.
You got any anime? No.
Anime.
My roommate is a cat. It's a story about a person who finds a stray cat. It's a little black kitten. And then halfway through the show, you get to see the cat's perspective. I'm going to watch the first episode, but I'm going to give it another watch. It's a cute idea. We've always needed to see what the cat is thinking, so now you'll know. In anime form.
A couple weeks ago, I did finish the Seven Deadly Sins.
Yeah.
Now nice. I just have the movie. There's a movie that I can watch on there too. It's like an hour and a half long.
Wow.
Yeah. So one more thing for me to watch on Seven Deadly Sins.
Hey, Into the Spider-Verse won an Oscar. That's pretty
Woo!
Awesome.
Yeah.
Anyway, Emily, thank you very much for joining us here on the show.
Thank you guys.
Thank you. Yeah, it was very nice.
We'll have you back anytime.
Cool. Also, I'm not one of Scott's girls that left a review.
Thank you. thank you.
Scott's Girls.
I didn't realize. Here's the thing. I feel like Scott's Girls is like Scott's girl left all those reviews and just has like
multiple accounts.
It's like multiple accounts, but one girl.
Just 10 reviews.
Because you read them and you're like, nah.
I don't know. Maybe you should read them. Ian.
I have read them, but they all seem very similar. We need like I need them to delve into the depths of what we're trying to talk about here and. But no, it's cool.
Even if one says,
thank you for being honest. Anyway, no, it's cool. We have like 21. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Thank you very much for leaving the reviews,
yeah.
Scott's roommate.
I do want to remind people to subscribe to our Twitch channel so we can get John Melanthai's all decked out.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'll do that.
All right, so Ian's on that. Let's close this up.
I just wanted to, I'm going to say again, thank you to Emily for being on the show. You're welcome back anytime. I want to thank all of our listeners and remind you that you can leave feedback on Twitbook, InstaFace, and Gramter at Couch Co-op Shows, all one word.
No hyphen.
Also, try following us on twitch.tv, The Couch Co-op Show, where we play all the video games sometimes, and you can watch us every Monday night at 7 p.m. doing this podcast right here. Remember, you can find our podcast on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Radio Public, and or Spotify. Subscribe, leave us some reviews, or just have Scott leave review. That would be awesome.
Free sticker for review. That's pretty solid.
You're running out of email addresses, Scott.
Okay. I want to thank Jared.
Of course.
Aaron.
Absolutely.
Scott.
Out.
And sitting in for Dave, Emily.
Woo.
For joining me here on the couch. For Couch Co-op, I'm Ian, reminding you to please be excellent to each other.
Wild Stallions.
Well done, boys.